All right, 5 minutes after 11 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in this Thursday morning. Beautiful day out there, by the way. Tomorrow looks just as beautiful, and the good news is the weekend looks just as beautiful. So not a bad time of year, right?
Yay!
It's a good time of year. There's a lot of clues left by successful people. Have you ever heard that before? You've heard that before, right?
Yes, I've heard that before.
In the book, The Go-Giver Influencer, the idea of dropping clues is very cleverly suggested, I guess, in the form of a story. And the only thing I don't know is if the story is a true story. So Bob Berg is going to tell us about this. Bob Berg is on the phone. He is a speaker. He's named one of the top 30 most influential thought leaders in business. I want to be one of them, Robin. Thought leaders. And it's got the book is really doing well on Amazon. I think the book is another author. Please forgive me for not having it in front of me. It is, John David Mann. There it is.
Yes.
Okay, Bob Berg and John David Mann. Bob Berg is on the phone right now. It's an honor to have you on our show. Bob, good morning.
Hey, Larry and Robin, the honor's mine.
Is this a true story? Is the Go-Giver Influencer a true story?
No, none of our parables are actually true stories, but the a lot of the incidents within those stories have actually happened in my life or John's life, and so we put a lot of these stories into a work of fiction.
So this is sort of like a parable to teach us how to be smarter in business.
I think smarter in business, more influential in life,
So it's in the eye of the beholder, because I'm reading it and seeing it as how it applies to business, but yet the way you just answered me means if I, right now, my thoughts were more about how to find a wife, then maybe I would see it that way. I would see it that way, wouldn't I?
I believe so. And, you know, you're right. It is a business book, and the publisher portfolio is a business publisher. So we do these business books, and yet we try to bring it kind of across the board to lessons of life, because like most universal laws and principles, they work in terms of financial, physical, spiritual, mental, emotional, social, and, you know, relational in all the various ways. But you're right. It is a business book.
So tell us about Jillian Waters and Jackson Hill. Tell us about those two. These are two characters you made up, right?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And in John David Mann, who you were kind enough to mention, he is really the lead writer and storyteller. I'm much more of a how-to guy. I'm the boring guy. I'm step one.
Okay.
John is a masterful storyteller. And you were saying earlier, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I didn't mean to interrupt you. There's a little delay, just so you know. I'm going to use that as an excuse for being rude, but but sometimes it is the truth. But I wanted to say that the idea of giving advice through a story is helpful, I think, for me anyway. I think I'm always the guy who hears the message clearer when it's told in a story.
Oh, I'm a lot like you in that way. And I think many people are, which is why parables have always been a great way of teaching, and stories have always been a great way of teaching. You know, there's an old saying in sales, which I think is half true, and the saying is, facts tell, stories sell. Again, it's half true. I think facts, or I think stories connect. And once you're able to connect on a heart level as opposed to just a head level, then you're able to sell, whether it's the idea, the philosophy. That's why when we talk about even the political discourse going on today that's so very negative, what I ask people to understand is if you're in a Facebook type of conversation, air quotes around conversation, with someone says, where someone writes, people like you are the worst people in the world, and you're blah 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 blah, and you just hate people.
Right.
You know, to come back to insult this person is not going to change them. You know, it's not going to. And the person who gets yelled at like this on social media or at a family gathering or at some sort of social function, ever notice they never respond by saying thank you so much for pointing out the error of my ways? I hadn't thought about it that way until you just insulted me and put down everything I believe in. So we need to be able to communicate in a way that's kind and tactful and respectful, but also in a way that's influential and persuasive. So Jillian and Jackson in the story both have something the other wanted. One is trying to sell a certain thing, and the other wants to buy it. So you think, well, here's a business marriage made in heaven.
Right.
And yet it's anything but that. In fact, every conversation they have, they seem to grow further apart, and they can't understand why, and they just can't believe the other person is thinking like they're thinking. And then they, of course, learn from their individual mentors that they haven't really considered what the other person's thinking. and that's a very important part of conversation and of understanding.
And even though it's about making money within the free enterprise system, you also talk about how many people can be served by an individual or a group of individuals. It's not just about making money.
Well, you know, and Robin, here's the thing, and that's a great point you bring up, because the free enterprise and free market capitalism itself is the greatest creator of wealth. It's the greatest creator of comfort in a free market, a free enterprise-based system, not cronyism, but actually true free market-based capitalism. It's where a bigger pie is created. And what happens is the only way in a free market-based system that you can make a lot of money is by first serving a lot of people. Because remember, no one's forced to buy from in a free market.
Yes.
Yeah, so yeah, I'll often say when I speak at a sales conference, the first thing I'll say is, you know, nobody's going to buy from you because you have a quota to meet.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah.
So that's really what it is. So I love Robin's point. I love your point that exactly. That's part of it. So it's not an either or. Either do good things or make money. No, you can only make money by first doing good things in a free market. In socialism, that's a whole different thing. That's all about force.
Yeah. Oh, I love what you're saying. Yeah. And it forces you as the business person to look introspectively, I guess, if you're not selling anything, or you're not selling as much as you should, because maybe what you've got needs tweaking.
Yeah, and probably your focus needs tweaking, because it's that person who can move from an I focus or me focus to an other focus who's the most successful. For example, when you think about it, what is selling? Well, by definition, selling is simply discovering what the other person needs, wants, or desires, and helping them to get it.
Help me understand this. I was going to use two different products, but I'm going to use the exact same product. Why is it that on one side of town you can open up, let's say, a franchise restaurant of some sort, fast food, and it fails, and then at the same time on the other side of town it opens up and it's very successful and lasts a long time? We have a couple Starbucks in our town that this applies to, and I don't understand, because they're selling the same product, it's the same price, and it's the same people. Is it location? Is it the personality of the people in the building? What do you think it might be?
The building itself?
Yeah.
Well, you know, depending upon the actual product or service, and in this case, it's a pretty generic type of thing. It could very well be the location. But it's typically not that. It's typically that the store and that the leadership within that store has a certain culture, and one of those cultures is much more attractive to people coming there.
That's what I think. And one isn't. Yeah. Yeah, I think you hit it on the head, and you don't even know the area we're talking about. But I think that's exactly right, and that's what I think happens too with salespeople. We see it in radio all the time. We'll have a salesperson come in here and just blow us out of the water with how good they are, and they're selling to the exact same people as other salespeople. I think absolutely right. They've got your personality, by the way. The way you sound on the phone is how they sound in person.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You talk about connecting, and part of the way to connect is to be a good listener also. But sometimes people have things in their mind. They only think one way, and then you've got this battle going on, like, my way is right because I'm talking louder than you and I'm not listening to what you have to say.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, Robin. I know some people, I describe them as, first they say something and then they believe it because they said it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But what happens a lot of times, and again, you see this in the political discourse, that a person will fall victim to what is called confirmation bias. And this is a term that's been going around a lot lately, and it means exactly what it sounds like. If they hear or read something that confirms their already held beliefs or biases, well, they believe it. It makes perfect sense. But if it's something that doesn't, that's not congruent with what they already believe, well, they ignore it. And the challenge with that is those people can't learn. You know, those are the people who, you know, my mind's made up, don't confuse me with the facts. And so that's why we have got to be better than that. We have got to open ourselves up to hearing the other person and learning why they think what they think. Now, this does not mean we have to agree with them. This does not mean we have to change our mind. It means we what we call it, and it's that fifth secret, it's letting go of having to be right. That doesn't mean you're not right. It doesn't mean you don't want to be right, that you're not going to prepare to be right, and
right,
so forth.
Right.
It means you go into learner's mode, and when you do that, you actually become stronger. You become more influential because you allow yourself to learn from the other person's perspective. Again, doesn't mean you agree.
You are a very prolific writer, and I want to use the writing part of you, the author part of you, to kind of illustrate what you just said. We, Robin and I, talk to authors all the time, and sometimes they're established, as you are, and sometimes they're brand new. And it's the brand new one I want to tell you about. We had a guy on, and he had a book, and it was doing pretty well. It was fiction fantasy, right, I think? Mm-hmm. And he was sending his manuscript out and not getting anywhere. And finally, he had the courage to write one of them that refused to. He said, "This is a great book. Why are you turning it down? Why are you turning it down?" And they wrote back. They said, "Well, because you've got some unresolved conflicts in here that you need to work on." Well, he told us that he changed five words in one sentence, mm-hmm. resubmitted it, and it was better. And he could have said, "Oh, you guys are full of yourselves. This is a great book. I'm going to, you know." And I think this happens a lot in publishing, I guess, that people are confident that their book is right. Just as you say, people are confident that their beliefs are right.
Right.
You know, and I think that's the same exact thing.
You know, I admire that author who did that, because, you know, you can really get stuck in an ego loop.
Yes.
And not allow yourself to learn, not allow yourself to grow. You know, when John and I were first, when our agent was bringing the original Go Giver book, which has been out 10 years now, and was bringing that to the different publishers, we got turned down by 25 publishers. And, you know, some of the feedback was, well, the world doesn't need another parable, or some just said, we don't like the storyline, or stuff. But there were also ones that had suggestions in there, and we really explored all of the suggestions, and, you know, some of them we felt were really worthwhile, and some, you know, we didn't think were as much so, and we did tweak it, and we did make some changes, and what we did is, you know, we made sure to say to ourselves, you know, when John and I would speak, it would be, you know, we got to really make sure that we don't take it personally, because
yes.
we're so attached, you know,
yes.
to the characters and so forth. So, yeah, I agree. We've got to be able to do that, or we simply can't grow.
And you're with Penguin Random House. I mean, they're one of the biggies.
And they have been, and yes, Penguin Random House is wonderful, and we're with their portfolio division, which is one of their book divisions. And I got to tell you, you know, because I've had, I think, 12 books out now altogether, and I've worked with several different publishing houses, and they've all been very nice people. This one is just amazing. I mean, they are the best publishing partner we could ever have. I mean, they're just the culture itself is very uplifting, and you feel like part of a family, and they're very supportive. So it's, you know, it's really been a team effort. The original book is now, we say 700,000 copies sold, but we just found out it hit the 800,000 mark, so we're tickled about that. But it's really a team effort, and, you know, if this book does as well, we'll be happy about it.
And you also ask people to grow within themselves. I mean, sometimes they get so jaded in you know, wanting to just push forward on something that they forget the other loves of their lives. I mean, you are a true animal level lover. You were on the board of directors of Furry Friends Adoption, and you had to take time out to put your talent and expertise elsewhere.
I do love animals, and of course your area is known for some of the most magnificent horses in the world, and it just must be a joy to be able to, you know, to interact with them. And I do love animals. They just and part of the story, of course, you know, John and his wife, they're animal lovers as well, so it was really fun to bring, you know, that animal kind of sub theme into the
I love that. I wanted to mention the name Angels and Furs, I think is what it was called, right? I just love the name. I need to be fair to the book and ask you to give us a thumbnail sketch of the storyline in the book for the listeners. But before I do that, let me tell you this. The book has had 16 reviews on Amazon so far. Every single one of the reviewers is giving it 5 stars. The book is currently number 15 in the category of management and leadership. So that is pretty impressive to be number 15. And it only came out like a month ago or so, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, April 10th. So we're not even a month old.
All right. So tell us the movie trailer version of the story. This is one of those interesting books because it gives you advice through a story. So give us the story if you could.
Yeah, so Jackson has he's a young entrepreneur. He's kind of a reluctant entrepreneur. He just happens to love animals, and he came up with a delicious tasting, very healthy dog food for his own dog, and found out that the neighbors' dogs and cats, you know, they loved it, and he started to expand. And there happens to be another place in town that is the head office for a pet supply store chain, and they had heard about his product, and so they want to bring his product line into their stores. He would like to sell it into the stores, but they want an exclusive. He's a little reticent about that because the product need to be locally sourced because of the freshness, and he's got clients already who he's very loyal to and who are loyal to him. So again, both want what each other has, but there's some sticking points, and neither of them are really understanding that in order to get past these sticking points, you've actually got to see it from the other person's point of view so that you can work within that, you know, and we're not talking about compromise. We're talking about collaboration. Not that there's not a time and place for compromise. There's a time and place for most everything, but typically compromise, as one of the mentors said, he said this jokingly, but he said compromise comes from the Greek word for nobody actually gets what they want and nobody feels good about it.
No, really? I love that. And if Congress could adapt the principles of what you just said, I think we'd be a better country.
Thank you.
And the life is very emotional, and sometimes people can't keep their emotions in check, and they let the emotions run rampant, and sometimes it's not good.
And that's a big thing, Robin, because one of the characters, the judge, Judge Celia Henshaw, was telling Jackson, her protege, because there were two proteges and two mentors. She was saying, if you let your emotions drive the car, you're putting your life at the mercy of a drunk driver. Because, you know, we operate as human beings. We're basically emotional creatures. Okay, we'd like to think we're logical, and to a certain extent we are, of course, but we're mainly emotional. We're emotion driven. We make major decisions based on emotion. We back up those decisions with logic. We rationalize, which means we tell ourselves rational lies, and we do this in order to justify that decision that we know we shouldn't have made, but we did anyway. And so we're not saying that we should forego our emotions or deny our emotions. That, you know, there's no need for that. Emotions bring us a lot of joy in life. But when it comes to logic and emotions, we need to be in control. We need to master our emotions as opposed to our emotions mastering us. That way, the decisions that we make have the greatest chances of having the results we want.
You talked about ego. I want you to talk about the second in command. Let me explain what I mean by that. A lot of times, the second in command, I'm going to use that as an overall statement, meaning it could be your brother, it could be your wife, it could be somebody else who's not necessarily doing what you're doing. But they love you, and when you show them or tell them what you're doing, they're going to say, oh, that's a great idea. But meanwhile, maybe they don't really think it. You know what I mean? So so that kind of positive feedback, just to spare you from having hurt feelings, is not necessarily a good thing. So how do you know A, that you're not getting feedback from the second in command, if, using my example. And if you are second in command, how do you get the guts to say, you know, those cookies you're trying to sell, they don't taste so good.
Mm-hmm. Right. You know? Right. Yeah. So let's take it from both viewpoints. First, you don't necessarily know if that person is being truthful with you or not, but you can make a decision based on prior knowledge about that person. For example, if there's a history of this person just sort of being so encouraging because they don't want to hurt your feelings and right. That's the way they are, right. Well, you kind of know that. And that's why I know with me, I used to have this person in my life. He was an older guy who was very negative about things. But he was a very good business person in his day. And I used to kind of utilize his advice in a mentor type of way in which I'd ask him if he thought an idea was good. And if he said no, that didn't necessarily mean to me it wasn't. But if he said yes, I knew it was.
You know what I mean? Yes,
but he
absolutely.
Didn't say yes. You're right. So if he said yes, you knew it was. But he was such an opposite person. He was a no person.
Well, that is true. so who do you go to, like, when you're trying to figure out if an idea is a good one or not? Do you have somebody that you can depend on will tell you the truth?
Yeah, I actually have some people in my life, about three or four people, who really are just, you know, we hold each other accountable, and we speak truth to each other. We do it in a kind, tactful way, although one of the people in the group, he doesn't really so much, but, you know, but it's okay, we all know that's just how he is, but...
People have to be comfortable in their own environment. I know, like, if I put on a piece of clothing and I'm a little bit uncomfortable in it, I'm, you know, fidgeting and I'm not at the top of my game. But if I put something on where I'm real comfortable in it and I know I look good, I can function a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think what that says is really we need to feel as though we're being congruent with our values. We need to feel comfortable with ourselves, and that's a good thing. You know, we'd expect it. And we wouldn't expect this one person in the group to be different than he is. We accept him for what he is because that's just him, you know. And,
exactly.
and he's a good thinker. He knows what he's talking about. So, yeah, we have a little group like that we kind of get together and meet. We share our ideas with each other, and we kind of hold each other accountable to them.
That's a good idea. I watched this documentary on Seinfeld one time, and I found it interesting that if you hear him tell a joke on The Tonight Show, that joke has already been tried and proven to be funny with like a number of nightclubs across the country. He'll take his jokes. So he can tell his joke to his partner, Larry David, or whoever, and if they both say, yeah, this is funny stuff, but they take it into a comedy club and nobody laughs, boom, they remove it from the act.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. No question about it. And that's a wonderful way to do it. You know, you don't test your best stuff in front of the Tonight Show crowd.
Right. Yeah.
You bring your proven material to the Tonight Show crowd.
The quote on the front of the book says, and I'm sure you love this one, from Marshall Goldsmith, the author of What Got You Here Won't Get You There. He wrote, "This may be the most important go-giver book yet, and in today's polarized world, it could not be more timely," unquote. And that's absolutely true. I have a copy of The Go-Giver Influencer. If you would like the copy that was sent to us, call me right now and I'll leave it for you here at the station. It's a little story about a most persuasive idea. That's the subtitle. Bob Berg and John David Mann wrote the book. So it's waiting for somebody to call in. Do you have a website? I know it's on Amazon. Do you have a website again? I think we went through.
Yeah. No, and they can get they can read the first two chapters if they'd like to see if they like where it's headed before clicking through to Amazon. They can just go to The Go-Giver without the hyphen, thegogiver.com, and click on the purple cover that they'll see on the homepage. It will take them to a page where they can get the first two chapters for free.
And how do you and John keep your objectivity about your own writing and about each other's writing without wanting to hurt any feelings?
Oh, well, John is a superior writer than I am, so it's easy.
he probably said the same thing.
In that case. I'm a how-to guy. You know, like I said, I'm how-to, and I'm kind of, John's a brilliant storyteller. So I think but also he's a very kind, humble guy. So it's like he never makes you feel like he's a better writer, you know, but you know he is. And, so,
oh my gosh.
And it's okay.
Oh my gosh. I heard this morning somebody referred to, instead of surfing the internet, surfing the ego net. We look at the I've also heard that ego is the biggest destroyer of any good idea, so and by the way, I love the name Go-Giver, because we always say the go-getter, Mm-hmm. But the go-giver, I love that. You're giving, and that's how you end up receiving. Just a beautiful idea.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much for being on the air with us, Bob. Tell John thank you.
I sure will. Thank you both.
All right, we will be right back.